Today we're going to talk about how to install OctoPi on the FiSec Spider version 1.1. Now, what you need to have to know is that I'm actually going to do 64-bit install for the OctoPi. So in this case, you're either required to have an OctoPi that runs on either Raspberry Pi 3 or 4, where it can handle 64-bit processing. So I'm not going to go into the advantages of 64-bit processing, but there'll be advantages for it in future tutorials. That's why I'm covering it. So some of the things I want to tell you about are there are multiple ways to actually connect your Raspberry Pi using your pins and the pins over in here, as well as you can use the serial USB connections between here. So I'm going to show you the basic install for the FiSec Spider version 1.1. And then in future tutorials, I'll talk a little bit more about that. So what we need to do first to prepare the install is take the actual SD card out right here. And I'm using a 16 gigabit SD card, but you can use larger. But in this case, this is what works for me. So I'm going to place it in this device so I can image it. So I'm going to place this in the computer. You may hear a beep. Then I'm going to go over to my desktop. And over on my desktop, you can see that I'm actually on the download page for downloading and setting this up. So I'm going to click over here to make sure I'm there. And then I'm going to go to the very bottom. And down at the bottom, you can see that there's actually a nightly build for 64-bit. So I'm going to click on that. And then I'm going to scroll all the way to the bottom, I believe. And as you can see, this is the current date being 10/13. I'll wake up in a minute. So now that we know where it is, all we have to do to download it is click on it. And it should download automatically. Now, I've already done the download, so it's in my actual downloads folder, which I'll show you in just a second. So in my downloads folder, what you'll see is the following. So inside here, I've downloaded it and extracted it already. This one is actually downloading as we speak. So we're going to go over to the Raspberry Pi imager that I downloaded. I'll leave a link in the description for you. I'm going to choose the operating system, then I'm going to say use custom, then I'm going to click on the OctoPi for the server version. It's 64-bit. So we'll click on that and we'll say open. Then we'll click on use our storage, or our storage device in this case, which is going to be our drive. And then I'll click write. Then I'll say, do I want to overwrite? And I'll say yes. Now this may take several minutes, so I'll pause the video for a second. And what essentially is happening is it's imaging your image file onto the SD card. So it's writing right now, and when this finishes, it'll say verifying. So we'll give that a moment, and then I'll show you the rest of the process. Okay, it's now nearing the verification point where the actual imaging is complete. So what I'm going to do in a second is I'm going to have to remove the drive and then reinsert it so that we can actually read from it. So I'm going to click continue, and then I'm going to go back over to my workbench for a second, pop out the drive so you can see it, put it back in the computer, and then I'm going to go over to the desktop again. I'm going to open a folder over here, which you'll see in just a second. And what I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to go to the boot drive. There's going to be two drives. This is a partition. And I'm going to look for the supplicant file. So if we open this up in Notepad++, we can actually see what to do here. So inside Notepad++, what you can see is that there's a WPA and WPA2. That's going to be the network that we're going to connect to in this case. It's going to be a Wi-Fi router. So I'm going to remove the comments like so, and I'll explain a little bit about this. Now that the comments are removed, it will actually access this when booting to connect to your network. So the SSID is the name of your network that you'll put right here. And then down here, you'll put the password to log into your network. So I'm going to close out of here because I've already created it. And I'm going to go to my downloads folder and copy it over. And the reason I'm doing that this way is to avoid you seeing what my network name is and what the password is. So I'll copy this. I'll go back over to the drive. I'll paste it right here. It'll say, do you want to replace? I'll say yes. So we're all set there for our configuration. So what I'm going to do now is go back over to the workbench, pop out the drive. I'm then going to insert the SD card back into our 64-bit Raspberry Pi 4. And I'm going to place this down in a second, but I have to grab the power cord. So give me a second here to prepare it for you. So the power cord actually came with a Canva kit. So if you don't have a good actual power cord, I suggest getting one because it gives you the right power. So I'm going to place this right here for you. And I'm actually going to power it up. And this will take a few seconds to actually boot. And while it's booting, what we can do is we can actually check to see what's going on in our network. So I'm going to open up the command line prompt so you can see what's going on my Windows-based machine. So over on my desktop, I'm going to type ARP minus A with the space in between, and then press Enter. And this will show me all the connected devices currently on my network. Now, recently, Windows may have made a change that'll affect your computer where you won't always see the device when it connects. So the other option is you can go to your router, log into it, and then look for connected devices. So in this case, my router in this case is obviously 192.168.1.1, and the computer I'm actually on is 192.168.1.2. And when I say the numbers, I leave out the dots because I assume you understand that, but it would actually be 192.168.1.2. And these are octets. And that has to do with the actual breakout of the bits because they can only go to a certain number. So now that we've waited for this, I'm going to up arrow to get the command again, and I'm going to ARP and see if it's there. So looking right here, I don't see it. So this would be the point where I'd probably go to my router. But in my case, I know relatively where it's going to be. So I'm going to ping 192.168.1.5 and see if I get a response. This is a way to tell if something's on a network. So there's no response as of yet. So we know that that's probably not the IP address. So as soon as this finishes, we'll up arrow twice and do ARP again to see if it's there. It's not. So we'll try 192.168.1.6 and press enter. And we're getting a response there. So let's do the up arrow for ARP again. And as you can see, it's now appearing. The other way you can do this to actually go to your router and see connected devices. So I know what the IP address is now, so I can go back over to the browser, open a new browser and type 192.168.1.6 and press enter. This will take us to our OctoPi, hopefully. So as you can see, it's loading. It's going to walk us through a setup wizard. So in the setup wizard, we're just going to hit next. We have nothing at the moment to upload or restore, so we're going to click next. We're going to create a username called Pi, and the password's going to be Raspberry, and then we're going to create an account. Now I'm not going to save it on my computer at the moment, so I'm going to say next, And then here it asks if you want to have anonymous tracking. I'm going to disable that in my case. You may want it. Then I'm going to click next. Then I'm going to test to see if it can see the host. So it can see the server and it's reachable. We'll see if we can do a name resolution. It can resolve the name. So we'll enable the connectivity check and click next. Now over here we have configure plugin blacklist processing. I'm going to enable that. Basically, there are certain things that I don't want to load, but you can read about this on your own. So I'll click enable for now. Next, I'm going to name this Octopi for the name of our printer in this instance, because you may have multiple devices that you want to have multiple print servers for. So I'm going to click next, then I'm going to click finish. Now you can see our environment. Now normally I'd walk you through the update process, but this is only 1 day old for the image that we pulled down. But to do that, you click on settings, and then down in here you can see software update. So there may be updates, but it says that we're currently at a stable version. So we'll click update to see if it works. And it looks like they're doing an update because something has recently changed. So that's a good thing. So what it may ask you to do is reboot or reset Octopi. We can deal with that just this once, but now you know the update process. So this is going to take a second to actually finish updating, but there's another update you can run. Now another thing that you're going to have to do to set this up is actually go back over to the desktop. So we'll wait for this to finish for a few seconds. And it's probably going to ask for the restart, which it's doing. So this is going to be a second. So I'm going to go back over to the desktop for a second. And I'm going to show you how to connect this. So I'm going to take the USB serial cable, plug it in here, take the other end, and plug it into our Phi6 Spider. And obviously it's not powering the Spider off the USB. So in this case, when we don't have PSU power, I'm gonna power it through the 5-volt line. So I'm gonna take this jumper and I'm gonna move it to the top two pins and put it back down and then plug it in and it will have power. Now, just so you know, the actual operating system, or excuse me, the firmware that I loaded on the Phi6 in this case was Marlin. And I have a basics video to explain how to do that, which I'll put in the upper right hand corner now. And so now that we're connected to the actual board where we have power, we can go back and test it. So I'm going to go over to the desktop. I'm going to say reload now. And now that it's reloaded, I'm going to click the connect button for everything set to auto. So as you can see now, it does give us a message saying, hey, there might be something you want to configure so that you can communicate with this. So you can click over, I believe there's a little thing for info, and this should open a website hopefully, but it may not. But there's a setting that's actually in Marlin that you can set. So I'll talk about that in future tutorials, but essentially if you go over to VS Code, I'm not sure of the actual setting off the top of my head, so we're gonna have to see what it is. I actually have it open to it, so I'll go back over to that so you can see it. And what it is it's host action commands. This allows it to communicate with Octopi when it's in the 64-bit configuration. So it's a bit of an advantage over previous configurations where you didn't have this functionality. So one other thing I want to show you real quick is something that a lot of people ask about, and that's setting up a camera. So you can do time-lapse photography over here, but you're gonna have to configure something like a USB camera. So I'm gonna go over to my desktop for a second and show you one. So over here, I've got a little USB camera that will point at these over here, and I'll plug in the actual camera. Now, it may not work right away. You may have to reboot your actual Raspberry Pi, but let's see what happens. So we're on there. We'll go back over to our desktop, and on our desktop, we'll see if we can see anything in the control view, which we can. So you can see that there's some blurry stuff. Those are actually the boards. So I'll see if I can wiggle my finger in front of it. So you know it's actually live. That's all you have to do to set it up. And then there's settings for time lapse that you can set over here if you so desire. But that should be the basics to get you going. So I want to thank a bunch of people for making this tutorial possible. First of all, my patrons, and second of all, the people that tip on PayPal. They've allowed me to offset the cost to make these tutorials for you. And I want to let everybody know to either like and subscribe so the videos will be more accessible to others. And everyone, take care, be safe, and I'll talk to you later.